I'm in London in the offices of Hermitage Capital. Hermitage Capital was founded by Bill Browder, who is now with me, and Bill has a very interesting story to tell. Actually, that interesting that he produced a YouTube video that you can see on YouTube and also on the Hermitage Capital website. Now, Bill, what is the story in this video that you are telling, and for who is it interesting?
The background is that for 10 years, I was the largest foreign portfolio investor in Russia, had more than $4 billion invested in the country. And our investment strategy at the time was to invest in badly run Russian companies, often where the companies had management that were doing things like stealing. Mm-hmm. And we would research how they went about doing their stealing and then publicly expose them.
What were some of the companies?
We were involved with Gazprom, Surgutneftegaz, Unified Energy Systems, a lot of the very largest Russian companies.
Yes.
And it was a very effective strategy. It was particularly effective when Putin first came to power, because he was fighting with the same oligarchs that we were fighting with. They were stealing power from him. They were stealing money from us. And so we would research how the theft would occur, and then we would put it into very simple PowerPoint presentations and then share it with the press. The press would write about it, and more often than not, the government would then step in and get rid of whatever the scheme was that was causing all these problems. Mm-hmm. And so as a result, we ended up stopping big thefts and big stealing from the companies we invested in, which was all very good. The share price of those companies went up as a result. The Russian government was better off because they often owned shares or had tax revenues from those companies. The only people who weren't happy about it were the guys doing the stealing. Mm-hmm. And so we ended up in a situation where this strategy worked beautifully up until 2005. And then all of a sudden I was flying back to Moscow after a business trip abroad. And I'd been living in Moscow for 10 years. They stopped me at the border. They detained me for 24 hours. They sent me back to London on a deportation flight, and then declared me a threat to national security. And I haven't been back into Russia since then.
Since 2005.
November 2005. Okay. The next thing that happened was even more outrageous than this. In June of 2007, our offices in Moscow were raided by the local Moscow tax police on the pretext of a tax investigation. And as they raided our office, they took away all of the seals, the corporate documents, and all of the registration papers for our three Russian investment holding companies. They took those documents, and then shortly thereafter, we discovered two things. One is that we no longer owned our Russian investment holding companies, and two, this group of criminals, somehow connected with the police, had fraudulently created and forged backdated contracts where our company supposedly owed more than $1 billion to some unknown companies. So it was all very, very scary. And on top of that, they took these, they went around to every one of our banks looking for our assets. The cops went with search warrants to all of our banks saying, where are the Hermitage Fund assets? Now, fortunately for us, after I got kicked out of Russia, the clients all asked for their money back. And so there was no money, there was no assets, no money left in Russia. So even though they had stolen our companies and created these judgments to go around and try to expropriate our assets, there was no assets left to expropriate.
So there was actually no harm to the clients.
There was no harm to the clients. However, and this is the most extraordinary thing I've ever seen, even not being able to get our assets, they still found a way of using this scheme to make money. And the way they did that was that our companies back in 2006 had made a huge profit and paid $230 million of taxes to the Russian government. And so what these criminals did was they took our companies, they used these fake judgments to file amended tax returns to say that, in fact, there was no profits back in 2006. It was just break even. And therefore, the taxes paid should be refunded. They applied for a tax refund, and within 48 hours were granted a $230 million tax refund from the Russian government. So they didn't steal from us, but the criminals, in conjunction with the police, stole $230 million essentially from the Russian government.
And this is the biggest tax refund ever done in Russia?
This is the largest tax refund in Russian history, awarded in 2 days. So who's involved in this whole thing? You got crooked cops, crooked tax collectors, organized criminals, and judges. So this was a quite extraordinary story. And on top of it, when we started to complain about this whole thing, to the authorities. We wrote various letters of complaint and criminal allegations and complaints and so on and so forth. Instead of acting on our complaints, the police turned on us and all of our lawyers.
After the police started going after all of our lawyers, it became clear that there was a real extreme danger for anyone working for us in Russia. We had 7 lawyers from 4 different law firms who were representing us. And I went to each of them and I said, I think it's time to leave Russia. I don't think it's safe anymore. Six of the 7 lawyers chose to leave the country, came to the UK. We had one lawyer, probably the best of all these lawyers, a young man named Sergey Magnitsky, who said, I haven't done anything wrong. Why should I leave the country? The law will protect me. And he stayed. Not only did he stay, but he did the most remarkable thing, which was he took the whole story that I've just described, and he went to the Russian State Investigative Committee, which is the Russia's equivalent to the FBI, and he testified against the police officers who were involved in the $230 million tax theft and the theft of our companies. He named their names and he told their roles. He did that in October of 2008. 1 month later, 3 subordinates of one of the men who he testified against came to his apartment and arrested him. They arrested Sergey, they put him in pretrial detention, and then they started to put pressure on him to withdraw his testimony. And the way that they did that was by moving him from one prison to the next, putting him in progressively worse conditions. They put him in cells with 8 inmates with only 4 beds, so they had to sleep in shifts, they would never turn the lights off at night. They wouldn't allow him food parcels when his family would deliver them. And they kept on putting more and more pressure on him, hoping that he would withdraw his testimony. But Sergey was a man of the law, and he was actually the most idealistic of all of our lawyers, and he refused to. And about 6 months into his incarceration, and this is probably the most horrible thing I've ever witnessed in my life, 6 months into his incarceration, because of the bad conditions that he had been exposed to in prison, he developed very serious gastrointestinal problems. He developed pancreatitis and gallstones. This is a extremely painful condition, but it's also a relatively minor condition if it's treated. And in the prison hospital, they prescribed an ultrasound and they prescribed possible surgery 3 months after it was diagnosed in June of 2009. 1 week before he was supposed to have his ultrasound, 1 week before he was supposed to have his possible operation, they moved him from Matryoshka Tishina prison, which is where they had a proper prison hospital, to the most horrible prison in Russia called Butyrka. It's a maximum security prison, and they refused to provide him any medical attention. And at that point, his condition seriously deteriorated, and he started to experience just excruciating pain so bad that he couldn't even lie down. His cellmate would bang on the door for hours asking for medical help for him. And when the doctor came 5 hours later in this one incident, I think they gave him aspirin or something like that. The whole thing was just so horrifying. He must have written 20 letters of complaint to the investigators, to the prosecutors, to the jail officials asking for medical attention. None was provided. And in fact, every time he wrote a letter of complaint, they would then further deteriorate his conditions in prison. They moved him to a cell without a toilet and just a hole in the floor where sewage would then bubble up from the floor. And they moved him to a cell where there was no window panes and just the cold air came in. The whole thing was just absolutely horrifying.